Hi there, my name is Brian Keller, technical evangelist for Microsoft. Thanks for joining us here for the Visual Studio 2013 launch. In this video, I'm going to be giving you an overview of several of the ways that Visual Studio 2013 is evolving to provide you with better application lifecycle management tooling. And before I dive into what's new with Visual Studio 2013, let me just give you a quick overview of Microsoft's Application Lifecycle Management portfolio. The start of our Application Lifecycle Management offering all centers around Team Foundation Server. Team Foundation Server was the first solution built from the ground up that was designed to integrate all of the artifacts across your software development lifecycle. So this includes not only your source control, but also work item tracking, which can be everything from a bug to a requirement. We added the ability for you to track test cases back in 2010. In 2012, we added feedback right into this process so that you can get end-user feedback directly into Team Foundation Server. And as part of that, we wrap everything up in what's called a process template. We ship out of the box with process templates for Scrum, for CMMI, and for Agile, but you can also customize these process templates to meet your requirements as well. We give end users of Team Foundation Server the ability to access Team Foundation Server from straight within Visual Studio. We have plugins for Eclipse. We even have web clients, and the whole thing is extensible as well. In fact, in 2013, we added the ability for you to use Git tooling with Team Foundation Server, and we now host Git repositories right within Team Foundation Server. I'll talk about more about that in a minute. Some of the trends that we're embracing for this release are really focused on the shift to a cloud computing model for a lot of applications. We also see that development teams are shipping more continuously than they ever have in the past. And so with that, there is a lot of ramifications on the way that we build software. We have to be able to continuously take feedback into the development process. We have to continuously ensure that quality is baked into everything that we do. We don't oftentimes have time to just spend a month or two testing software like we used to if we're shipping software to production every 3 weeks. And so quality really needs to be just an ongoing thing that we do. And then, of course, continuous delivery. This is partnering between the development team and the operations team to make sure that we can quickly and reliably go from code that we check into source control to running software that's available in production that our end users can get access to. Now, this also feeds into what we call a build, measure, learn cycle. So as you're building software iteratively, you're hopefully getting continuous feedback that's going to flow back into the development team and give you insights into what you can make better in the next iteration, or bugs that you need to fix, or new features that you might need to add. Now, along the way, this really breaks down into four major areas of application lifecycle management, and I'm going to talk about some of the problems we're trying to solve in this release and some of the solutions that we have other videos on that you can go watch to discover how we're trying to make these problems go away. The first of which is just planning, and this is where you turn ideas into requirements that you're then going to write software around. One of the common challenges we see these days is that while Agile and Scrum and some of these other Agile methodologies have given us a great framework for working on a team of maybe 5 to 10 and working together as an autonomous unit, it hasn't really helped us to scale that Agile across the entire organization. So one of the requests I hear from a lot of teams is, how do you manage several teams that might be sprinting alongside one another? How do you manage those teams in such a way that they can put together, they can work together towards a larger common goal? And the other thing that you need to keep in mind there is that as you're starting to push these teams together and align them, you still want to keep track of what made them successful as individual teams. And so we want to help them maintain the autonomy that they're used to that helped them succeed in the first place as, for example, a Scrum team. Now I'm using terms like Scrum and Agile, but I want you to understand that our tools will work regardless of the process template that you're using. So we're highly flexible in that manner. So one of the things that we've done to help you scale Agile across your entire organization is we've shipped a set of capabilities that we call Agile Portfolio Management. And in another video, Greg Bohr will actually take you through a demonstration of how agile project management allows you to structure your work in such a way that you can get either a top-down view, maybe as a management team, or as an individual sprint team, you can take a look at a bottoms-up view to see how the work that you're doing contributes to the broader release backlog that the entire team is working against. We also introduced capabilities that allow individual teams to customize the way that they practice Agile without requiring changes to that process template across the entire organization. So you can now change the Kanban board on a per team basis. You can add metadata to your work items that are called work item tags so that you can represent tags that make sense to your team without requiring that every other team embraces the same set of tags or process template. Another set of challenges that Visual Studio has always sought to solve is that of helping development teams be more successful as programmers or as programmers working with other teams of geographically distributed programmers. More often than not, most of the organizations that I work with on a daily basis are distributed teams. They may have a core headquarters where the majority of their software development workforce is located, but they oftentimes have other team members who are located in various geographies around the world. How do you manage those teams and give them a set of tools that they can use to collaborate more effectively together? We also need to continue to give developers great tools to help them understand the complex code bases that we are shipping. Unfortunately, software seems to be getting more and more complex the more ambitious problems we're trying to solve. And so for an end-user developer to be able to quickly understand how the changes to the code that they're working on might impact other developers or other pieces of the code base, that's critically important to shipping high-quality software. And finally, as we're shifting to more of a cloud services model where we're running applications in the cloud that are expected to make efficient use of resources while still scaling to thousands or millions of end users, we really need to make sure that we're baking in scale testing to what we're doing. So as part of the solution, you'll see in this release that we've delivered several capabilities, far more than I've listed here, but these are just a few of my favorites. The first of which is called Team Room. Team Room is both a real-time collaborative chat room that your users can, or your development team can go to talk about what's going on with a particular sprint, or maybe if you need somebody to take a look at a bug fix you just checked in, it's an easy way for you to request help directly within a web client. But it also exposes lots of interesting, rich events that are coming off of Team Foundation's server. So anytime a build happens, you'll see an event that gets logged within Team Room. Anytime a new bug is filed against the team, that will show up in Team Room. And then finally, it provides you with an ability to go back in time and see what maybe happened yesterday. Maybe if you were out of the office yesterday, you want to see that the team was struggling through a bug that you may have maybe introduced before you left for the weekend. So those types of scenarios are possible. I mentioned earlier we added Git as a source control option for Team Foundation server. So what that means is you can choose to set up a Git repository and take advantage of all of the distributed version control options that Git gives you, but you also can maintain the integrated ALM capabilities that are afforded by Team Foundation server and being able to link work items together with builds and source control and so on. And finally, we've given you the ability to run those load tests I was talking about as a service using Team Foundation service so that we can really help you load test on demand, and you can push all of the heavy lifting of setting up and executing those tests up to the cloud. So there's another video within the quality track which will take you through how that works. Finally, we are, as a team, oftentimes challenged now to release on a continuous basis and embrace continuous delivery, and that really requires a partnership between development and operations. And as part of ensuring high quality, oftentimes teams will set up multiple environments. Maybe it's a dev, test, staging, production environment, or maybe even additional environments. I see a lot of teams that set up multiple testing environments to simulate multiple real-world environments that they might expect their software to run. and managing the flow of software between your daily builds and all of those individual environments can oftentimes become very complex. It requires teamwork across multiple disparate organizations, maybe between dev, QA, and operations, and it really requires a first-class set of management software that's going to help you manage all of those different releases. That's why earlier this year, Microsoft acquired a piece of technology called InRelease, which was built by one of our partners that builds on top of Team Foundation Server. And we started to integrate release management directly within Team Foundation Server. And so now for the first time with the release of Team Foundation Server 2013, you can utilize the release management solution that we've been working with so that you can actually manage all of those releases across those environments. We've also partnered with our friends in the Windows Server team, who is now taking advantage of configuration-based deployments. And what that means is that you can actually version control the configuration requirements for your application, and as your application evolves, so can the configuration needs. That means that when you get ready to release your application, it already contains all of the information that the IT professionals need, so that when they actually push that out to the server, it already contains this configuration file, which can configure the necessary roles and other properties of the server that it's going to be executing on. Finally, our job as software development teams is not done the moment we hand software off to operations. Oftentimes, we get a call at 3 o'clock in the morning because there is a production issue that needs to be resolved. The challenge is that you can't just hook up a Visual Studio debugger and expect to have permission to do that within your production environment. And so this means that production incidents are oftentimes difficult to reproduce and even harder to troubleshoot even once you can reproduce them. And so one of the things that we've done is we've made it possible for you to use tools like IntelliTrace over in those production environments so that you can actually capture everything that the .NET execution stack is doing as your application is running. And what this means is I can capture rich information about exceptions or performance threshold violations. I can take those back to Visual Studio Ultimate, and I can then step back in time to see what was actually happening in the .NET stack when I encountered a problem. And we've also partnered with our friends in the System Center team to integrate Team Foundation Server with System Center Operations Manager. What this means is that as an IT professional running Operations Manager, if I encounter an exception on a particular server that I think might require the development team to take a look at, I can just assign that incident over to operations, or over to engineering, rather, and that will create a new incident in Team Foundation Server. And when the developer opens that up, it should thankfully contain everything that the developer needs to understand what was happening on that machine, and of course, more importantly, to turn around a fix. So this just shows you a few of the different areas that we've continued to invest in application lifecycle management tooling with this release. And these are just a few. There's a whole lot more in here that I would encourage you to take a look at. Thanks for watching. And for more information, go check out the other videos in this track, which include hands-on demonstrations so you can see these capabilities in action.